cloud is a big deal, that like cloud database of services is a big deal. When you try to actually move your data into these databases that you don't actually control, you find that there's some issues with the existing tools. For example, in the cloud with databases and services, you usually do not have access to file systems. And without the file system, you can't use Percona Extra Backup. And without using Percona Extra Backup, you have to use MySQL Dump. Now, if you have a large and busy data set, as we have alluded to already that many people have this problem, with MySQL Dump, you will have a negative performance penalty on the source database as you run it, which could cause you to slow down your application or take it down completely, which is probably not acceptable for a lot of use cases. Another thing that we have kind of issues with is replication. In the clouds, usually the providers don't necessarily expose the MySQL replication interface directly to you. They usually have some sort of wrapper on top of it. The thing about these wrappers is that sometimes they will only offer a subset of what MySQL kind of allows you to do. So for example, and a provider might only allow you to replicate with GTID-based replication through their proprietary interface, and another cloud provider that maybe you have data on doesn't provide you with GTID replication at all. So then you have this situation where you can't set up replication between these two providers, and you're stuck, right? So without replication, you can't synchronize the data. Without being able to synchronize the data, then you have to stop writes to the source database to ensure a data consistency. And stopping writes is, again, maybe unacceptable for your use cases. So unrelated to the cloud and the downtime in general is that sometimes you don't necessarily want to move like a whole database. Maybe you want to move a subset of the database. Maybe you want to move a subset of a table subject to a where constraint. And existing tools, while MySQL Dump, something like that, can do that, MySQL replication does not allow you to filter on a per row basis. And this is problematic if you want to only move a subset, which has some applications inside the context of sharding, if, depending on how you perform your sharding strategy. And lastly, the existing tools all have this kind of drawback where it's just a bunch of tools and a bunch of command line options and flags that you have to know. And I, off the top of my head, cannot tell you how to migrate a data set from one place to another off just like with the existing tools off the top of my head. And if you're not a DBA and just an application owner, this might be a very daunting process for you. So that's another drawback of the existing tools. So in response to kind of all the problems that I just discussed, we created GhostFurry. GhostFurry provides a single binary solution that allows you to move data from one place to another with a single command. In addition to being a command line application, it is also a library, a Go library specifically. So you can build custom migration flows and customize it as much as you want to be able to filter for arbitrary data or even change data on the fly, like anything you want really. So it's very flexible in that sense. At Shopify, we have deployed GhostFurry into production, and we have moved well over 70 terabytes of data at this point using it, and that kind of proves the reliability of the tool. And we're also very confident in the underlying algorithm's correctness, as we have used formal methods to model the algorithm and understood it and found bugs and fixed it before we even wrote a single line of code. So we're very confident in its correctness. And as of today, the tool is also open source under the MIT license under the URL there. And I will be talking about it more later. So if you want to learn more about it later, you can come to my talk later today at 4:50 in room G or browse the code on GitHub that we posted. And that is all I have to say about GhostFurry.
Light, or they've built a perpetual motion machine. If you're mathematics, you get emails to say that you know how to prove Fermat's last theorem, although that was proven a few years ago, so maybe less so now. And then, of course, in computer science, what's the crackpot email we get? Anybody? P equals NP, right? So even I don't do theory, I don't do algorithms, even I get emails with people who have crazy ideas in the context of databases to say that they've been able to prove that P equals NP. So I got this email a few years ago that says they have a magical database that can do anything in constant time, right? They can sort data in constant time, which we know is not true. So the way I've been tracking my success as a new professor is over the years, just keeping track of every single crazy email that I get, right? And so you start off getting none, and then over time it gets better and better. And then what happened was in 2016, I had this inflection point where we started getting way more crazy emails. And this is because we started publishing and doing research in the context of using artificial intelligence and machine learning to automate a lot of the DBA processes, right? So this example here, this person tells me they can build the Terminator of databases, right? But then something happened last year where you see now this point where all of a sudden the number of crazy emails just dropped precipitously. And turned out what happened here was this is when Oracle announced that they've built the world's first self-driving database system. So I guess now all the crazy people are emailing Larry Ellison instead of emailing me. So you may be thinking that this is just sort of a marketing term, right? Some asshole came up with this idea and to capture the buzz on self-driving cars and apply it to databases. And so what I'll say is that, yes, it's very similar to what research we've done in the past on autonomous systems. It's just been called different things. So the 1970s, when the first databases came out, this is called self-adaptive systems. The 1990s, they were called self-tuning systems. And now we're just calling this self-driving systems. So you would be sort of half correct thinking it was an asshole that came up with this term, right, because it was me. But what I'll say is that self-driving systems are actually different than what this earlier work does for two key reasons. So all of this earlier work tried to solve this first problem here of what to change, right? What indexes to add, what knobs to tune, how to do materialized views. But what these older things do, but the newer systems are going to try to do, is figure out when to actually apply these changes, right? Know what the workload looks like and know when it's the right time to do maintenance. And then the hardest part of all of this is that when you apply a change, how do you actually determine whether that was a good idea, right? Are you actually getting a real benefit from this? And the reason why this is hard, because the hardware can change, the workload can change, your application can change, and you don't know whether the index that you added in the past is actually helping you in your workload in the future, or whether just the workload itself has changed. So I'll talk more about this in my talk today at 11:30, and I'll cover, again, more background on what self-driving database systems look like, and I'll talk about some research projects we've been doing in this area. Okay, thank you.
Well, I'm not sure if our next speaker is going to talk about how many crazy emails he gets, but I suspect he probably gets a lot of them. I'd like to welcome up Tomas Ulin. He's a vice president for the MySQL engineering team at Oracle, responsible for the development and maintenance of MySQL-related software products. Prior to working with MySQL, he was in the telecom industry, working for the Swedish telecom operator Telia and telecom vendor Ericsson. He has a master's degree in computer science and applied physics from Case Western Reserve University, and a PhD in computer science from the Royal Institute of Technology. Please welcome Tomas.
Wow. Am I on? Yeah. So I had memorized how I should start this talk, but then Andy came up and I cracked up, so now I forgot how to start this. I guess most of you already saw the good news from our side that MySQL 8 is out. It was released last week, and of course that's what I'm going to talk about today. And for those of you who don't know me, I lost sound, I think. Okay, now we're back. I've been with MySQL since 2003. Been in databases since 2001, where I was working on a database for telecom applications, which is now known as MySQL Cluster. Okay, so MySQL 8. On the first slide here, of course, MySQL is known for a relational database, doing SQL, and of course, MySQL 8 has a lot of improvements in that area. But what is less known, and what I want to advertise here, so if you go away from here and you only take one thing with you, I want you to know that with MySQL 8, we have great NoSQL doc store support. Okay, this should also be a familiar slide. MySQL is powering the web. We've seen Peter showing how MySQL is everywhere. It feels like sound is coming and going, is it? Okay.
It's when you look right, it's better than mic.
Okay. Maybe it's my great tattoo here that I want to make sure that the photographer gets a good picture of. Okay, thanks. MySQL powers the web. But of course, the web is not static. It evolves over time. We've seen also in several talks before here, early on, Facebook and Sugo from YouTube was thinking, okay, it's only the very, very big web properties that are going to have to worry about scale and so on. But okay, the web evolves. And our claim is that the MySQL has succeeded very well with evolving with the web. The last release was, of course, 5.7. You know that. In the course of 5.7, we also introduced NODB cluster, which is HA made easy with for MySQL. So if you haven't had a chance to take a look at NODB cluster, you should. And of course, what we're going to talk today about is MySQL 8.0. And without question, just doing the numbers internally with all the things that we have developed and also the fact that we've been hiring engineers over the year, it's been now since about 2.5 years since we released 5.7. This is by far the biggest increment and the biggest addition to the MySQL release history. It's just so many things there, and of course I won't have time to cover it all, but I'll try to sort of bring out some highlights, and then you have the rest of the 2 days here to go to listen to the MySQL talks to learn more in detail. So coming back to what I was talking about on the first slide, the document store, which I want to really try to promote here. With 8.0, we now have full JSON support. We've added a new dev API, just to make sure that everybody understands, because now with this dev API, you don't have to have any SQL knowledge whatsoever. You don't have to set up schemas, think about your relationals. You can just start in your favorite language, whether it's Node or it's Java or .NET, C++, or whatever. We have connectors that enables you to work with this very simple CRUD API, which is simple in its starting point, but then, of course, it has a lot of advanced features that you can make use of as you move down that path. So it's a very modern API. It has all these sort of things that you're used to, like method chaining, asynchronous execution, and so on. So I really recommend that you take a look at what we've built here. So looking at it from more sort of graphical picture, you still have your relational tables there, but then also you have your documents, your collections, and so on. I think one of the strengths here is, of course, you can mix and match the two, and then you can use the strength of the SQL language to actually access these collections and make very, very advanced queries on your data. So you can choose to have part of your data set in traditional relational. You can have it as documents, or you can mix the two together so you can have some part of your schema relational, and then you can use JSON to extend your relational table. Very, very powerful, we think. And if you are for some reason considering to start up a parallel project using a document store or some sort of NoSQL, I really encourage you to take a look at what MySQL can do for you there to avoid spreading yourself across a number of data sets. Looking more at the data store, designed for modern developers, we've really taken sort of a ground-up approach here to make sure that we make something really targeted to the modern developer, where you have built-in support in IDEs, where you can get auto-completion. We've worked with the documentation from the ground up, very intuitive documentation, following tutorials, examples, so you can sort of successively build up your knowledge, and it gets really easy to access this new technology. At the core of this is the new shell that, again, I encourage you to take a look at, have a chance. We've had so much good feedback around this shell so far. You can do rapid prototyping. You can go into a JavaScript prompt and work directly there. And it's, it can just looking at the feedback that we've gotten on blogs and so on, this is really popular. And I know when we've done tutorials and webinars and so on, this we get very, very good feedback on this tool. I'll come back to the shell a bit later. To be able to jump between these two worlds, documents or unstructured JSON data and SQL, we have a very powerful function which is called the JSON table function, where you can actually bring out your data from your JSON formatted data, and then you get regular tables where you can do all the SQL that you want on top of that. Very, very powerful. I want to also highlight that MySQL 8 will continue to evolve. As we've done with 5.7, you've seen a number of JSON functions come out. You've seen InnoDB cluster come out, being revved, improved. We will continue to do that with 8. And here's just a preview of one of the things that are currently on labs. So we'll come in an upcoming release of MySQL 8, where you have the ability to have also nested JSON objects, and then you'll be able to flatten those out with the JSON table function. And there's a whole list of JSON functions here. What you see in bold here are the things that we've added from 5.7 to 8.0. So just to summarize, JSON, doc store, very, very powerful. And if I would single out a feature which we've received feedback around, positive feedback around, in 5.7 and 8, I think JSON would be one of those. The JSON support that we have is one of those things that would definitely come way up there on the top. Of course, if you the JSON, of course, blobs or in the database. And in the first implementation, these were just blobs. You would do an update, and you would have to rewrite the whole blob, right? So that's efficient internally in the database, but it's also inefficient for the replication chain, where, of course, if you rewrite the whole blob, then, of course, the whole blob travels through the whole replication chain. So what we've done in 8.0 is made it possible to do partial JSON updates. So this is true for internal optimizations, but also for the replication chain. And you can see how from, the left-hand side of the slide, where in the earlier version, you could either choose to have, the minimal information in the binary log, or the full information, full rows or partial rows, you would get different sizes. And you have a similar thing in the new setup, of course, if you have full rows, and of course everything goes in. But if you only have partial rows, then the amount of information that you actually have to replicate becomes very, very, very small. Okay. So moving over to another thing that we've done with 8.0, which was probably one of our biggest projects, which have been going on for quite some time. To be honest, I think we actually had plans to release this in 5.7, but that never happened. But now it's there. It's our new data dictionary. And there's just so many things that are being enabled with the data dictionary. It's just much, much, much cleaner inside. So one of the reasons why we did this was to make sure that we have a good code base to continue to evolve rapidly on top. But we also get some benefits from it. So now when we consolidated the data dictionary into one place, we get away with some inconsistencies that could happen between the InnoDB data dictionary and the other data dictionary. It's now atomic and crash safe. I'll come back to some other benefits shortly. As I said initially, we continue to improve the SQL support. And if I would single out a feature or a set of features around the SQL domain that we've received most attention about, it would probably be around the CTEs and window functions. These are, if you're not familiar with them, it's fairly complex. And if you know it, there's no point in me explaining the concept. If you are interested, I really encourage you to go into the sessions later to learn more about these powerful SQL clauses that we've introduced. Another thing which we actually introduced quite early in the 8.0 cycles, you know, we have our DMRs, so it's been around for quite some time, but it has also been one of those features that have received a lot of attention, where we've got a lot of good feedback, and this is how we are able to, with the no wait and skip locked, for example, in a booking system, which is a traditional example where you just want to find in a scan, you want to find an empty seat. Now you don't get stuck on the first locked row and waiting for that one to get unlocked to actually find. Now you can do things like no waits and skip lock. Very, very powerful SQL here. And here's another which is more geared towards making it easy to manage your database. Invisible indexes. Either if you create a new index or if you want to remove an index, there's always this uncertainty around how is this going to affect the database running, right? And if I make a mistake and I delete and I didn't think things through, it can go really bad, right? The whole database can basically die from having to do full table scans where it's supposed to be using an index and so on. But now what we've introduced, you can actually have, it's like a trash can bin where you can actually move it, but it's not actually removed, it's still there. And what I forgot to say, of course, if you realize that you did the mistake, it takes forever to recreate it if you have a big database. But now you can actually just move it into being in a hidden state. It's still maintained, it's still correct, and so on. So if you then discover a few minutes later or hours later or how long you want to sort of monitor this before you actually feel confident, you can then say, okay, I'm fine, actually remove it, or this was not good, just turn it on again, and then, of course, it's there again, and your application and your database starts behaving the way it was doing before. Okay, so SQL roles is something new that we've introduced, making it much, much easier to manage, basically, privileges instead of on the individual person level. So, great new addition. We've done performance improvements. This is an example in the sys schema and performance schema. If you're not familiar with performance schema and sys schema, you really should be getting on to like 5.7, 8.0 and the latest releases, because it's such a powerful set of instructions or tools that you can get insights in what's going on in the system. And improvements here that we've done, this is basically about selecting the right index for performing these kind of queries. So here's another benefit from the work that we've done with the data dictionary. So you should probably know, or you do know, that information schema had some performance problems. If you grew the number of tables, there was just some queries that you would not run in information schema because of this. But now with a new data dictionary, we see how in red here the actual execution time comes down a lot. And for certain like out increments here, it's huge, right? And also for static table info and so on. So huge gains, and information in schema basically becomes useful in the setup. Another thing that we should be aware of is that we've changed the default in 8.0 to UTF-8, and that is because it's really the de facto standard out there, what people are using to a large extent. So that's where you get all the support for emojis, that's where you get all the language support, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, and so on. So this is where people go. But if you're doing some comparison maybe in some simple benchmark or something, you may, in an older version, make sure that you're running the same setup here in configuration. So another thing that we've done with 8 is really beefed up our GIS support. It started already in 5.7. So now we have full GIS support, very, very powerful. And I think what's important here is that to know is that this is based on software which is available open source in Boost. So it's experts actually developing the algorithms and so on, ensuring that correctness. And previous versions of MySQL, going back before 5.7, there was our own homegrown GIS. And yeah, we weren't experts in GIS. Now we have, we can leverage basically the experts in the era. Here is also a very appreciated features around persisting configuration information. Instead of having then, okay, you go and change some configuration information in the database, then you have to go and sort of change your master repository for the configurations, and you have to maintain these in two places if you want to restart the server and so on, or stage it somewhere else, and you want to make sure it comes up in the same way. Now you can actually persist the changes, so when there's a restart, for example, you actually come up with the same set of configurations that you had when you started. In the latest DMR here, we also added on feedback from you guys capturing timestamps on the user that actually changed the configuration value. InnoDB improvements, a lot of improvements, some related to the docstore JSON with the partial update. We have a new scalable, right ahead logging here, but I guess it's the redo log with a lock-free design and a lot of things. I'm running out of time here, so I'm going to skip slides a bit quickly, but we've done a lot of InnoDB improvements. Here's another thing that's coming down the line that we want to advertise, something that we've worked with Tencent, a contribution from them, so we'll have the instant ad column that they've done, which is a very neat solution and we liked, so hopefully you'll appreciate that when it comes out. Tons of replication improvements. Worked with JF booking and evaluating some of the work that we've done on the write set parallel. And we got feedback around a 10x better performance there. I guess there are blogs out there from JF that you can delve into if you want to. We've done the JSON document and then tons of other things as well. Group replication, also a lot of improvements here based on feedback that we've gotten on the first iterations of this. And again, some advertisement for InnoDB cluster, which is, okay, group replication, MySQL shell, the MySQL router, HA made simple. And you can operate and run this through this shell that I talked about earlier, not only for doing your, if you want to work in a docstore mode or something, but this is also the shell where you can, the one-stop shop where you can actually just manage and orchestrate your system as well. Okay, I know you've been waiting for these slides. Show them every time, of course. And we continue to improve our performance and scalability. These are for the read-only, and I think you're fairly familiar with our success in improving scalability on read-only. But one of the big things with 8.0 is the redo logging, the write-ahead logging that I talked about, and the great work that was done there, which is, means that our read-write benchmarks now are also boosted significantly. And I encourage you to join either or both of Sunny's talks or Dimitri's talks to dig into the details of this. And of course, tons of new features you can learn about in the coming sessions. Another thing that we added here was the upgrade checker as well. You want to upgrade to 8, what are the possible problems that you could encounter? This tool will identify potential issues and also advise you on actions that you can take. So to summarize, with 8.0, we continue to innovate and evolve. Docstore, huge thing. We continue to improve our InnoDB cluster story. HA made easy. Our SQL is better. We have tons of new JSON stuff. GIS is a first-class citizen in the database with all the support that you would expect from a GIS implementation, competitive with other competitors. And then if improving replication and all the things that you expect to see in a new version of MySQL around reliability, observability, et cetera, et cetera. And I'll finish off with this slide with all the things that you can learn. Pick either from here or from the schedule that you can find on the website or in the app. a lot of good stuff here delivered by the people who actually implemented these things. So you can ask questions and hear things directly from the horse's mouth. Thank you very much.
Our final speaker today is Brendan Gregg. Brendan is an industry expert in computing performance and cloud computing. He's a senior performance architect at Netflix, where he does performance design, evaluation, analysis, and tuning. He is the author of Systems Performance, published by Prentice Hall, and received the USENIX LISA Award for Outstanding Achievement in System Administration. Brendan has created performance analysis tools included in multiple operating systems, and visualizations and methodologies for performance analysis, including flame graphs. Please welcome Brendan Gregg.
G'day, my name is Brendan, and I'm going to talk about Linux performance in 2018. This is something that I do at Netflix, and so giving a state of Linux performance is very easy for me to do. But the first thing I want to discuss is that Linux changes very rapidly. We have a release every 2 to 3 months, and I've got a chart here, you can check it out online, that shows how many commits appear in each of the Linux releases. There's about 10,000 commits, and about 1 million lines of code change with every Linux release. There's two problems with this. One problem is it's hard to keep up to date with what's happening with Linux. And so I'm really grateful to have this opportunity to summarize what's been happening in Linux performance here today. Another problem with Linux and the rate of change is that Linux doesn't really do much marketing. Linux is not a startup that's competing with many other companies who would have a VP of marketing and a marketing team and a marketing budget. And so what often happens is there's some really cool and interesting features going to Linux that you don't hear about. And so I get to talk about some of them now. I'm an engineer and I do this technically, but you can treat some of this as a way to get awareness that marketing normally would have served. How do we keep up to date with Linux? I subscribe to LKML. It's something I would not recommend anyone else doing unless you're doing kernel engineering. LKML is the Linux kernel mailing list. It gets around 400 emails a day. I don't read them all. If I tried to read them all, I would get nothing else done. And so what a lot of us do is we filter based on the subsystem we're interested in. So I'm always looking at performance updates. I'm looking at BPF updates and so on. Something that's much more gentle is to subscribe to Linux Weekly News. And this is especially helpful as they have technical journalists who summarize what's going on in Linux, and they will do updates about 4 times a week to show what's going on in the Linux kernel. But if there's one thing I'd like us all to do, and that is to check kernel newbies. Does anyone already check kernel newbies? So we've got about a dozen people. So this is, they have an update every time there's a new Linux kernel release, and you can treat this as the release notes for Linux. At the top of that update, they have a summary of prominent features that's about a paragraph long. And so that's, if there's just one thing I would like you to do, one takeaway, and that is every 2 to 3 months, check out the kernel newbies when they do the update and read that paragraph so that you have awareness of what's going into Linux. But what's happening in Linux in 2018? The first topic I'd love to talk about is Meltdown Inspector. Hands up if you've heard about Meltdown Inspector. All right, pretty much everyone. Meltdown Inspector are terrifying security vulnerabilities. And they involve speculative execution and low-level processor details. I have never seen an issue as bad as this ever in my career. And in order to fix Meltdown Inspector, there was simply no simple way. Intel couldn't just release a microcode update that fixed everything. And so what's ended up having to happen is every piece of software we touch and hardware has had to change to mitigate these vulnerabilities. If you are deployed in a cloud, the cloud hypervisor has had to change. So there's been patches. If you're on Amazon EC2, you'll know early in January performance went down a bit, then it improved a bit when they updated that patch. The Linux kernel, which I want to talk about, it has its own patches. It's the kernel page table isolation patches. Applications like MySQL, all applications need to be recompiled with the new Repline compiler option. And then CPUs have microcode updates as well. So this changes everything. And all of these have a performance impact, all of these updates. It is terrifying. Fortunately, the engineers working on this have paid close attention to performance, and so the degradations we will suffer in 2018 won't be as bad as they could have been. To give you an idea, I ran MySQL with a Sysbench workload on Server Ray, which was Linux 4.14 before the KPTI patches. I was accomplishing 31,000 requests per second. On Server B, which is the same server, but just with the KPTI patches applied, that dropped by 27%. I'm running the system at CPU capacity just so that I can get an accurate measure of how the performance, the degradation of the performance. And the reason for the degradation of performance is it is the KPTI patches that go into Linux, they flush the translation look-aside buffer. Each time there are various events, context switches and interrupts and I/O. What happens, the TLB, and you might remember this if you did computer science many years ago, the MMU is what's used for virtual to physical address translation. Each time you do loads and stores, the MMU is translating so that your virtual memory address space, you are actually accessing main memory, physical main memory. These translations are slow. Loads and stores happen all the time in our code whenever you're accessing data. And so to speed this up, there is a side cache on the MMU called the TLB. And that's great, except the TLB has a fixed size. If things don't fit in the TLB, the hardware will then have to go to the reference, which is in main memory, and do page table walks. And that's the big problem with the KPTI patches, is they flush the TLB, so we have to do page table walks much more often. I haven't seen TLB issues for a long time. When I started doing performance about 15 years ago, I did see TLB issues, but now I've had to go and create new performance tools, and so I open sourced this TLB stat so that I can measure the CPU cycles spent doing TLB miswalks, and I could see that data TLB and instruction TLB are both higher thanks to the KPTI patches. And so that's decreasing the instructions per cycle, which is it's like a miles per gallon. This is the number one metric we use to understand low-level CPU performance. Fortunately, it shouldn't be that bad. And so here's some benchmarks that show I'm varying the syscall rate to show the performance loss for the KPTI patches. And it can be as bad as 600% slower if you're doing 10 million syscalls a second. If you're doing a much more gentle rate, the performance loss goes down, and there are ways to improve it. And so PCID is a kernel feature that was fully fixed in Linux 4.14. That improves performance. And there's also transparent huge pages, because the TLB normally is in 4 kilobyte page size. By using huge pages, it gives the TLB greater reach, and it can repopulate more quickly. And so I was able to bring down the performance loss you should experience. Where you are on this graph depends on your syscall rate, your I/O rate, your context switch rate, and that will tell you whether you're looking at hopefully it's only a 2% performance loss and not a 20% performance loss like my Sysbench example. So that's Meltdown Inspector. A lot of work has gone into Linux to make sure that the performance impact is minimal. Enhanced BPF is another hotness of Linux for the last couple of years. And when the patches were first added to Linux, the lead developer, Alexei Storitoyev, said, this allows you to do crazy things. This is normally the words you don't tell Linus when you want him to accept patches into the kernel. But fortunately, the patches were accepted. enhanced BPF puts a virtual machine in the kernel that we can program from user space. And so it's being used for all sorts of things, doing DDoS mitigation, intrusion detection, container security, observability. I'm particularly interested in the observability angle, and I've been creating tools, and so this is the eBPF BCC tools that are open sourced. And I've drawn a diagram of the kernel, just a generic diagram, and I've shown where the tools fit in, what each of them do. Now, there's tools for looking at file system performance. There's tools for looking at the scheduler performance and so on. What BPF and the enhancements to BPF lets us do is the Linux kernel already had a lot of instrumentation. So it had kprobes for kernel dynamic tracing, uprobes for user-level dynamic tracing. It had ftrace. It had perf events. eBPF gives us programmatic functionality so that we can create custom latency histograms in the kernel. We can associate events together. I can create a custom timestamp from one event and then retrieve at another so that I can look at latency at different points. One of my favorite types of tools is inspired by in databases when you have wait states and you want to break down a query into the different states where it's waiting. And so I like to do that with kernel events as well. Where am I waiting during a file system operation, or where am I waiting when I'm waiting on the scheduler to schedule me back on CPU? And BPF lets us create all these new tools for new insights into how the kernel runs. And so this is all open source. You do need to be on at least Linux 4.4 to make use of them. And the newer the kernel you're on, the more of the tools will work as eBPF has been added piecemeal. To give an example of an BPF tool, this is bio latency, and it's showing block I/O disk latency, and it's summarizing this histogram in kernel, so it's very efficient. The only thing that's passed from kernel to user space is the count column, so it's just an array of numbers. Normally, prior to eBPF, we had to dump all block I/O events to user space and then post-process, so it was prohibitive in terms of 24/7 monitoring, but now we can do these custom histograms in the kernel, export them out, monitor them 24/7, not just for disk latency, but for anything, TCP latency, scheduler latency, and so on. Another example tool to show a different type of capability out of BPF is my off-CPU time tool. This is rather interesting as it's showing the kernel stacks when you block and go off CPU versus the time it takes to go off CPU. Has anyone used CPU flame graphs? CPU flame graphs. All right, so we have a lot of people. CPU flame graphs show why an application is consuming CPU. Off CPU flame graphs are their complement. This shows why you block, and then the stack trace is responsible for blocking. This is MySQL, and I'm running it with a workload, and I can then investigate the off-CPU time, the blocking time, whether it's in locks, whether it's in disk I/O, whether it's in scheduler latency. It's a really great catch-all for everything that's not exposed through a normal CPU profile. And so I really like using this to complete my analysis of what an application is doing. But there's other uses of BPF as well. So this is XDP, and this is a feature that was added into Linux 4.8, and it's been getting enhanced and improved. XDP is using BPF to improve in-kernel networking and to speed things up. This graph is from Netronome, and it shows how normally with IP tables, BPF can make performance 3 times better, doing 3 times the packet rate. And with hardware offload on cards, which is now starting to appear on networking cards, we can take that even further. And this is one of the reasons why IP tables is now giving way to BPF-based solutions in Linux. There's going to be a lot more of this. I work at Netflix, and quite often people say, I would like you to try out our monitoring solution. I'd like you to try out our software solution from startups. Often these involve running an agent on our systems as root. Now, that makes me a bit nervous, and it makes our security team a bit nervous about trusting a startup with running an agent as root, because a root daemon can do basically anything. BPF is really interesting because it allows things to run in a secure virtual machine, a sandbox, where it can't interfere negatively with the kernel, and it can't do anything naughty that it shouldn't do. All the BPF programs go through a verifier first. So we will see, over time, more and more things like XDP, where some great kernel capability, instead of being made available through kernel patches or through a daemon that you have to run, it's now made available through a BPF program. Someone has already predicted that in the future, there will be no more loadable modules from third-party vendors. These will all become BPF programs. And I can see, I mean, that's the dream, but I can see where that's heading as a Netflix employee, because if third parties are coming up and saying, run my BPF program, I know it's running in a sandbox context, and so I can trust that much better. Other exciting things that are happening in Linux, BBR is the new TCP congestion algorithm that was contributed by Google that appeared in Linux 4.9. And it's been designed to really excel with packet loss environments, which is what we see in the real world. My colleague, Emma Aether, on the performance and operating systems team at Netflix, he's been testing this on 0% packet loss networks. BBR does not help, so its performance is the same as Cubic. But once you start to add in some packet loss, which you'll see for external networks, BBR really starts to excel. These graphs from AMA show a 1% packet loss where BBR is able to maintain 3 times better throughput than Cubic. And so there's some other references in my slides. BBR is exciting. We're looking to deploy and use that more. Another interesting feature I wanted to mention is Kyber. Kyber was added in Linux 4.12 along with another I/O scheduler. And this is improving the read and write latency to storage devices. How it works is it has target read and write latencies that you can tune. The target read latency, I think by default, is 2 milliseconds, and the write latency is 10 milliseconds. What normally happens, or to put it this way, when someone tells me I have a storage I/O problem, I have really bad storage I/O latency, there's usually two culprits. One, the disk is dying, and you're seeing really crazy I/O latency. Or two, you've got queuing. And so the kernel has done a write flush and has sent out 100 I/O or 300 I/O to the dispatch queue. And then you've done a high-priority read that's blocking the application, and that read is queued behind all of the writes. So Kyber, it keeps the dispatch queues very short. So we'll never send 100 write I/O to the dispatch queue, or we might. Kyber looks at the I/O completion times, so it understands if I feed that many I/O into the write queue, and then a read comes along, what's its latency going to be, and will I be able to satisfy a target? And so it constantly adjusts the length of the dispatch queue based on feedback of how the I/O subsystem is working. So that's, and it actually works. We've tested it, and we've found that our 99th percentile latencies can be reduced as much as 300-fold thanks to Kyber. And that was contributed by Facebook. But there's a lot more has been happening in performance in Linux. From 4.4 to 4.16, there's been TCP listener has become lockless to improve it. We've had the copy file range syscall for improving performance there. And there's been many EPOL related improvements. There's the kernel connection multiplexer, which should improve network performance. and so on and so on and so on. There's the BFQIS scheduler was added as well. There's also many minor improvements. So one of the biggest things that's been developed is the Linux perf tool, Linux perf. And so it's been getting capabilities so it can look at scheduler statistics, the sched time hist. It's been getting eBPF capabilities and so on. And so it's much more powerful now. CPU scheduling is always getting improved. Futexes, NUMA, huge pages, and so on. And so the newer Linux kernel you can get on, the better, because there's always these constant improvements that are happening. If you're wondering how I can keep up to date with all of this, then that's kind of the point. It's how do we stay relevant and up to date, and that's to browse the major features on kernel newbies. It is a really good source for understanding the new things that are happening. And so you can do that. It's, like I said, this is a very low commitment for us all to do. I know we're all busy, and Linux is just one small part of everything that you do. And so once every 2 to 3 months, there'll be a new release notes, and you can just look at the major features and see what's interesting. But also to run latest, because a lot of work does go into it, and that is... It's something a lot of engineers, we're very proud of what we get into Linux, but it can take a while for it to get deployed into production. So please run latest whenever you can. I have some Linux performance resources as a final slide, and that's my talk. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Brendan. And I was glad to say you did not recommend that we all sign up for a mailing list that sends us an additional 400 emails a day, because I don't think I could handle an additional 400 emails a day. So that wraps up the keynotes for this morning. I want to thank all of our speakers, I think everybody did a great job. Had I known that Peter was going to heckle some of our speakers, I probably would not have let him introduce you. So I'll remember that for next year. We're going to take a little break. The exhibit hall is open. I believe there's coffee out there. We've got demos starting over there at 11. There is one session before lunch, and lunch is at 12:20. Again, it'll be back in the Hyatt. You'll see the signs over there, over by the bar area. So thank you very much, and have a fabulous day. Mm-hmm.